In this video, I want to present a few priming patents for handgun ammunition which have been or are produced conventionally. Some of them are forgotten nowadays or have never been common very much. The shown cartridges or parts are not mine, but they are property of Werner Richter. Let's start with the first developments and go forward to the present day. In my books and internet sources, some patent dates don't match, so please excuse me any deviations. After the years with a protracted process of singly loading of propellant, bullet and primer, a number of patents were developed, often during the same time, which should minimize the disadvantages. The first wholesome cartridge, which includes all these three components, was a needle-fire cartridge registered by Nikolaus Dreise, later Nikolaus von Dreise. He completed his development in the later 1920s and instituted with a newly constructed needle-fire rifle adopted by the Prussian army in 1848 a new era. To fire the bullet, a needle was pierced through the propellant into the ignition device, which was located in the back of the sabot. Because of this design, the ignition needle, or maybe firing pin, was in the center of the burning propellant, exposed to high pressure and heat, which shortened the span of usability. This disadvantage was reduced by the Frenchman Antoine Chassepot in 1858. Here you can see a particular disassembled historic cartridge in good condition. The needle sticks shortly into the chamber compared to Dreise's patent. In both systems, cartridges were made of paper or other burning materials that the rifles were able to reload a cartridge without extracting any case. A characteristic which no other mass-produced cartridge had for more than 100 years until the G11 appeared. In the year 1835, Germany got the first locomotive, also more than 20 years before Chassepot had his mentioned patent, an extinct priming system entered the stage. The Frenchman Casimir Le Facheux produced pinfire cartridges which had been gas-tied to the rear. The hammer hits the pin, which pinches the priming composition in a cup in the inner case. Primary used in revolvers and single-loading long guns, they were able to ignite if they were dropped on a hard ground. Also, the shooter need to notice the right direction during the reloading process. The shown case has an unused primer. You can see the cup with the ignition device. A similar system was developed by the German Wilhelm Collard, produced in his own manufacture, later led it by his son. The whole priming system was twisted 90 degrees and in the center of the base. Also, the pin was fully countersunk in the head. Like many old developments of this topic, the following one was French. The gunsmith Louis Flaubert registered his idea of a rimfire case in 1846, more than 10 years before the French needlefire improvement was born. That time he produced these cartridges and guns for himself for 1 year already. The priming chemicals are located annular in the rim of the cartridge, which is squeezed between the chamber and the firing pin. Sadly, the cases are not easily reloadable, and originally there was no added propellant. Nowadays 4mm, 6mm and 9mm are still in use, but the most common cartridge with this kind of primer is a 22 long rifle with added powder. It took a few years, more precisely until 1859, until the first idea to bypass Flaubert's patent was registered. This ammunition, called cupfire, conceived by Willard Ellis and John White, were used in revolvers. The case had neither a rim nor an extractor groove. Instead of that, the case had an enlarged mouth to push to the barrel. This kind of shape only allows a reloading from the front side of the cylinder. Maybe you could call it a relocated rimfire cartridge without a rim. The case head has an inverted hemispherical shape or is moved forward to fill it more easily with priming chemicals. In difference to the rimfire ammo, these ones doesn't have a fixed anvil to pinch the ignition substance. This ammo was produced up to 870 in the calibers 28, 30 and 42. The lipfire cartridge was used in revolvers. It is like a rimfire cartridge whose rim is reduced to an eighth of the base. It became common, also like the cupfire and the following two patents, almost exclusively in the United States. This was favored by the Civil War and the isolation of the Confederates. Officially it was said you wanted to save primer chemicals. Ethan Allen, a gun and ammo manufacturer with headquarters in Worcester, Massachusetts, registered this patent in the year 1860. This ammunition was used in their own revolvers, that time Allen and Wheelock. Guns and cartridges were produced in the calibers 25, 32, 36 and 44. This one is a Navy variant of 36. The total number of produced revolvers are around 1250 units. In the year 1864, Daniel Moore and David Williamson registered the idea of their teatfire cartridge parallel to their revolver. It was loaded likely the cupfire cartridges from the front of the cylinder. The primer substance located in the teat, which was bashed between the hammer and the anvil, which was part of the cylinder. The first in series produced cartridges had a flat tip, but that was too difficult to twist in the correct azimuth. From 1870 to the end of the production, ammunition was only built with a round teat because it was faster to load. Revolvers and cartridges are built in the calibers 32 and 45. The second caliber was only produced with a round tip. The whole number of all revolvers of this concept made is around 30,000 units. Only 1 year later, 1865, followed the next try to bypass Flaubert's rimfire patent. Silas Crispin from New York reset the rim a little closer to the mouth, which made a special two-piece cylinder or a shaped breech in rifles necessary. The loads were produced in 31, 36, 44 and 50 Crispin. The exhibited cartridge that you see is in 50. This ammo has never been very common. In the same year, an American named Edward Maynard made his idea officially valid. The primerless case had a strong and oversized head. Some similar patents for primerless breech loaders had been registered in that time, but I'd like to come back to this one later. In the center of the head has been a flash hole where the ignition spark should pass through. After a number of blind alleys, in the year 1866, a modern, still used kind of ignition was registered by the US-American Hiram Burden. In that year, the French needle fire system was finished. Different to Flaubert and his counterfeit copies, this was a centerfire cartridge. The firing pin hits the cartridge head in the center instead of an annular point. The primer explosives are inside a soft metal cup, which is in a hole in the head. To discharge, the primer chemicals are squashed between the firing pin and the anvil, which is a part of the case. The ignition sparks pass usually through two flash holes into the propellant. You could say, the case has got a small piston of a, that time, common muzzleloader. Ammo with this kind of primers are often used in military service or in steel cases because it is difficult to reload them. Now, in 1867, I come back to the Maynard cartridge. The inventor expanded his idea, and that not only in a theoretic way, but he sold an add-on kit for his existing loads. This original example in good condition is made of two thin plates of copper. The plate closer to the propellant includes a small amount of ignition explosives in a perforated pocket. By sticking on this primer plate, a complete cartridge is made. After 6 years, Maynard abandoned the primerless production. In 1868, the just 2 years old idea of Hiram Burden was improved by the Brit Edward Boxer. Technically, Boxer's system was very similar to Burden's brainchild, but the anvil, which is independent from the case, makes a reloading much more easy. The case has got a so-called primer pocket in the head, in which one the complete ignition system is inserted. Also, the flash hole in the center is larger than Burden's system. To reload a discharged case, you can easily push out the primer components in a hole with a small metal stick through the flash hole. The new primer has already got a new anvil. Nearly every civilian and a lot of military centerfire cases are equipped with these primers today, except shot shells. In the same year, the US-American Colonel Bennett from Frankfurt Arsenal realized a nowadays extinct technology. Down in the head of the case, a cup was inserted and fixed by a stamped notch. This cup had two flash holes and a small pocket for the ignition chemicals. The anvil was, in difference to the most other patents, without a tip which concentrates the power of the firing pin. First tinned iron inlays were used, after 1860 copper ones were used. Because of the complex and expensive manufacture, the production was ceased a couple of years later. The most common shot primers are similar to Boxer's improvement 2 years ago. This one was registered in 1870 by the French inventor Ernest Goupilard. Here you can see the US patent drawings of his US patent 876. In scheme number 5, the breech face would be upside and the flash would hit downside. In December 1922, John Olin improved this a little and called it battery cup. I made this in the drawing. You can hardly see the ignition material, red, at the top of the anvil, green. Fixed by the inner cup, blue. It looked like a small case with an oversized anvil. Nearly every shot shell is equipped with this patent nowadays. During World War II, several nations experimented with electric primed handgun ammo. Among the advantages are a shortened trigger time warp and the missing mechanics. Maybe it would be possible to make a trigger like a mouse click. Some special ammunition is more easy, more reliable to build, or more compact with this kind of ignition. For example, the P-11 submarine pistol with 5 single-loaded barrels. For civilian use, Föhre produced the first electric primed rifle in series in the early 1990s. They were made in 2 different caseless calibers. Only hunting ammunition was available in the calibers 5.7mm UCC yellow and 6mm UCC blue. So, here we are, that's all for today. If I have shown somebody any new, aroused or satisfied some interest, I would be glad. Please excuse my mistakes, English is a foreign language for me. Feel free to write a comment.